What's good, YouTube? It's your boy Tony D2Wild checking in once again. Tony Digital bringing back another 1440p visual, back with another bang of the day, guys. And I was on the internet skimming around looking for some vids, some sneaker stuff, you feel me, to get things back and popping, panties dropping. And we were looking around, I seen something on GQ Sports. GQ's been putting out great content revolving around sneakers, fashion, culture, and all the above. And they have a video out 2 months ago where a sneaker expert breaks down the NBA's 9 greatest sneakers ever. Game points, GQ Sports. So, I can't even say that correctly. Might need to get a beer. Let's go ahead and pop this bitch off, though. Let's get it. I'll leave a link down below in the description to this video, as well as GQ Sports, where they make great things. I need to make sure I'm not subscribed on this channel, unfortunately. Let's fix that. Let's go.
Magazine, and today we'll be looking at some of our favorite sneakers ever
worn in NBA. My brother, Max, do I need to send you a motherfucking webcam or something? My man is shooting on a goddamn potato right now, man. Jeez, man. My quality can't even bring that quality up. What is this on? God damn. I can't even help. I'm sorry, guys. We're going to have to just, hopefully there's pictures or something. Game points. Let's get it. It's a good topic.
Michael Jordan.
Okay. Air Jordan Concord.
So the photos you're looking at here from May 7th, 1995. It's the first time that MJ ever wore the 11 on court.
Bro, look at the fucking, how these bitches, how flexible and how these are. Like, look at them bitches are about to explode. But damn, them bitches look good back then. They look just as good as they did back then as they do now. Look at Shaq's shoes. Them things laced up like crazy.
Concord colorway, of course. MJ was not supposed to wear this shoe in this game. Tinker Hatfield, his legendary sneaker designer, gave him a few samples to look at. This is right after he came back from baseball. You know, he played in 17 regular season NBA games to finish out the 95 season. Then in the second round of the playoffs, he told Tinker, yo, I'm going to wear these shoes. Like, there's nothing you can do to stop me. But Tinker was saying, nah, they don't come out till November. Like, they're not ready yet. And then he wears them and boom. Lightning, bottle, every cliche.
Look at the sole of them, like, back then, bro. That's, like, straight. There's blue tint, but they're, like, and people hate the blue tint, right? But these are, like, milk blue. They're not white. They're milky, though. They're not like the ones that we got recently either. They're like a mixture of light. Let me grab them. Hold on. Like, they're very close. They are close, though. I'm looking at them. Maybe my pair's just not dirty enough. Maybe I got to get my pair a little bit more dirty. But, like, now they do look very close, though. People be hating, like, people was hating, like, they hate the blue tint. They like the cream tint, whatever. These look about the same. It doesn't look as translucent, though, on that, like, on the shoe. But they remind me a lot, too, of these. Like, these were all, like, really milky. These are just like those milky, but they're not blue tinted. They're just straight milky. They were never blue on this. There was never blue. So it's like a mixture of these two together. But it's very close to the OG. And he's got the 45 on the back, which I don't know why they didn't embroider that for us, but it is what it is, man. Damn, bitches are shining, though.
You could think of, shoe takes off like crazy. He goes on to wear the Concord the entire season. They win 72 games. In the playoffs, he's wearing the bread 11.
I mean, them look just like the ones we got recently. Like, they look exactly like it. I need to wear my breads more. I got them put up somewhere. I need to wear them bitches more. Damn, do I got two pair of breads or not? I hope I got two pairs of breads. I got two pair of Concords.
It's the black and red. That's a combination. They win the fourth championship on Father's Day. He cries hysterically. He misses his late father. He's rolling around on the floor, and he's wearing the bread 11s in that moment. And then there's a famous photo of him in the locker room after he's crying. The biggest smile. He looks like the Joker. He's smoking a cigar. He's got the championship hat on. He's still wearing his jersey. And his feet are kicked up on the table. And you just see the outsole of the bread 11s. And it's a masterpiece. It's the best of the best. So you put all that together and it all equals into, hands down, no argument, no competition, the best basketball sneaker ever made. There's nothing that even comes close.
Why would you put this up? Am I at the? Why would this be the number? Like, why not say this to the last?
Technology, yes. Colorways, yes. History, yes. By far, the best. Patent leather, first time we'd ever seen that on a basketball sneaker. Carbon fiber, first time we'd seen that in a basketball sneaker.
I mean, technically it is throughout the whole sole, but you put it on the shank. Like, you put the air, like, you should have put the air, like, right here. It's muted. Why would you put this at number, like, the first shoe? Like,
I've seen that. This is his best shoe, and that says a lot because MJ has the best signature sneaker line of all time. Any sport, any basketball player. LeBron James. This was a game in December of 2017, in year 15 for LeBron. This was his last season with the Cavs. This was really the first moment that we knew how special.
I got a pair of 15. They're good.
The LeBron 15 would go down to be in sneaker history, in LeBron sneaker history. But this moment right here happened in Washington, D.C. And this was LeBron, honestly, just understanding the magnitude.
Hairline was still looking funny back then.
Of being LeBron James and the power that his voice and his actions carried. He wore one white shoe and one black shoe. They each had a quality plastered on the side of them. And when you zoom in on photos of these sneakers, Nike put the word equality in almost as many languages as they could find. On the white shoe,
oh wow, I did not know that.
On the black shoe, those words are done up in black. Wow. So it's tough to see when you look far away. And this is, of course, LeBron's history with the White House is well documented by now. He had a few tweets going back and forth. So this was LeBron's way of, you know, he wasn't trying to be rude to anyone. He was just trying to say.
And I remember, like, when the equality thing was pushing hard during that All-Star weekend in New Orleans. They had the big equality billboard and all that. I would have gotten those back then if I could have. But, unfortunately, they were hard to get back then.
We're all in this together. Let's be in this together. And let's find a way to move forward. Black or white, it doesn't matter the color of your skin. Let's just find a way to move forward. This shoe would go on to be super limited release. They released 400 pairs of each colorway. And then proceeds were then donated to the Smithsonian after that. This was just a way to propel the message that LeBron started with these Equality 15s. Kobe Bryant.
Now we saw the picture on the thumbnail. We saw the picture on the thumbnail, and I would agree it needs to be the Grinch. The Grinch is probably the best to me. Yeah. Respect.
Man, Kobe's history in the game of basketball deserves a book, a movie, 10 of these videos. It deserves way more than this little moment, but if we could pay tribute to Kobe's innovative mind right here, even beyond the Grinch sixes that we're looking at, because everything that Kobe did was in...
Damn, bro. I just thought about that, like, damn, Kobe's gone, bro, like... The way he just said that, like, it kind of hit me, like, again, like, it needs a book, it needs a story, it needs a movie, like, why are we saying that? Like, why are we saying that about Jordan? And, I mean, I know Jordan's got his little thing, but, like, why are we saying that? And it's like, we're saying that because his life is done, his life is over, you know what I'm saying? His legacy is not his voice. His everything about him is still here, but him as a person, his life, he's not, you know what I'm saying? It's like, it just hit different, bro, hearing that.
Could pay tribute to Kobe's innovative mind right here.
Like, if you don't know what's going on, you would wonder, like, why wouldn't he say that about Jordan or LeBron? Like, why is he saying this about Kobe, you know? And it's like, well, because... He's no longer here. That just hit me. My bad, y'all. It really did, though.
Even beyond the Grinch sixes that we're looking at, because everything that Kobe did was in a mission to A, get better, and B, to win. He was heavily, heavily involved in his signature line with Nike. And part of the reason for that is the things that Adidas didn't end very well with him, with Kobe, because they didn't really take his input. So with Nike and Eric Avar, who was a legendary sneaker designer who worked on a bunch of these Kobes, Kobe was involved down to the millimeter. He would talk about the airbag. He would talk about the inflation on the airbag. He would talk about uppers. He would talk about shoelaces, collar heights, heel cups. He would talk about everything. He would talk about TPU and EVA foams. He knew everything down to the exact millimeter. So before we even talk about this Kobe 6 right here, we have to talk about the Kobe 4. Because the Kobe 4 was the first Nike in modern Nike history to be a low-top basketball shoe. But the Kobe 6 right here is an evolution of the Kobe 4 and 5, which were both low-tops. Kobe 4, depending on where you ask, it might be the best Kobe of all time. Kobe 5 then built upon that. And with this Kobe 6, which is, in my opinion, the best Kobe of all time, and we're looking at, in my opinion, the best colorway of all time, the Grinch, the Kobe 6 took what those two...
Nike, bro, y'all need to just do the right thing when it comes to this and, like, just make a lot of pairs. Like, I know y'all would never do this, but, like, do a pre-sale. Just do a pre-sale, bro. Like, let people just go in and order it, like... You know, you would never do that. I know you wouldn't, but just try to do something right. Cause this everybody deserve. Everybody's gonna want this shoe. Everybody like it. Just we all would love to get this shoe, bro. This is the closest we will ever get to Kobe. You know what I'm saying? This right here.
Two shoes did, and it elevated it with storytelling. So you still had a low top sneaker. You still had the heel support. That was instrumental in preventing ankle sprains, because the whole thing that people were always afraid of was if you wear low top basketball shoes, you'll sprain your ankle, wah, 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 which isn't the case. Avar and the team, they found that if you put the right heel lockdown in a basketball shoe, your ankle will be stable. So that was the secret formula. And now once you had that, they added a plastic layer on top of the Kobe 6, on the upper of the Kobe 6, to mimic snakeskin. And this goes back to the Black Mamba. This goes back to Kobe being Kobe and winning. And being relentless and never giving up and having no fear. So they put that type of mentality, the Mamba mentality, on the Kobe 6 here. And its debut happened on Christmas Day against the Heat with this Grinch colorway. And again, this goes back to Nike using these big moments, Christmas Day games, All-Star games, the Olympics, finals,
they playoffs, don't do that no more.
Big moments to make statements with footwear. And this was a huge...
And hopefully we get something like that back. This upcoming year with the Kobe 6 coming back, LeBron 8's coming back, which we'll be talking about later tonight on the main channel.
Statement. There was no way this colorway matched Lakers' uniforms, but the NBA let Kobe run with it. And to this day, the Kobe 6 in this Grinch colorway is an extremely elusive shoe, extremely sought after, extremely well-respected. And it is because not only of its amazing design, but it really is representation of Kobe's mentality. And, you know, all that he left us with and all that we saw him growing to be. Man, damn. If this isn't the most polarizing sneaker.
So, wait, we got two Kobes in that motherfucker. That's about right. Now, this shoe, God, I love it. Kobe made one of the best basketball shoes and one of the ugliest at the same time.
Sneaker in basketball history, I don't know what it is. You know, a lot of people really hate this shoe. And
I can't lie, like, this picture right there. They don't look that bad. It's like some of them just look horrible. I wouldn't mind owning this shoe, though. Like, I would own this shoe. Adidas needs to re-release this shoe. They dropped so many crazy eights, but they never dropped. Like, I don't think they ever restocked the Kobe 2. Let me see how much Kobe 2 Adidas is going for. 500 and... That's not bad. Wait. Oh, you can get these bitches. Well, there's a fucked up pair. Oh, wait. There's a fucked up pair for $150, $250. They're not that. There's not that many. Some, like, the dead stock one is going for, like, $5. Yeah, it's a lot. Yeah. We'll see if they ever come out. Adidas.
And a lot of people have developed a new love for it now that the time has passed. But no matter what you feel about this shoe, you feel it, like, really passionately. And that's because it is one of the most uniquely designed sneakers that we've ever seen in the NBA.
Who the fuck made this? Like, what were they trying to do? Like, did they know anything about basketball? Like, this shoe is some shit that Alexander Wang or Y3 would have made now. Like, one of these fucking designer guys would have made now. But who the fuck made this? I want to know what they were trying to do. Were they trying to make, like, a new basketball? Did they think they were actually doing something with this? I don't know how it is as far as on the inside and how it is as far as the support in actual, like, in the actual basketball, but as far as, like, the aesthetics to it, like, what the, were they trying to make it, like, mixing basketball with style? Like, what were they, what was their, let's see if Max knows.
It's designed in conjunction with Audi. So, you know, you have a hood-like upper line.
Oh, he said, one of the most, he just said Audi?
Uniquely designed sneakers that we've ever seen in the NBA. It was designed in conjunction with Audi. So, you know, you have a hood-like upper, just like you would have a hood on a car. It hid the laces underneath the hood. You had the midsole built into the actual upper, which was kind of crazy. Like, it, midsoles are defined as midsoles because they're a different part of the sneaker. You want to have something you can land on when you're jumping up and down. So to build that into the upper of the shoe, unless it's done perfectly and with, like, expert craftsmanship, might not work out so well. And of course, this was the shoe that some people say forced Kobe to buy himself out of his Adidas contract, just because of its forward-thinking design, to be diplomatic. The best part of this shoe is opening night of the 2001 season. Kobe played in the USA-themed colorway of the shoe as a tribute to 9/11. So, you know, this was an early indication of just how well Kobe would use footwear to tell stories.
And fun fact, which y'all probably know, but I think that colorway, or maybe it was another one too. Let me see. I think, yep, I was right. So, well, a couple of them actually, but, you know, LeBron's worn these in high school, but I don't know which one it was. I think it might have been the yellow ones, because I know he played in these, and then, like I said, yeah, LeBron played in a couple of them. Like, apparently Kobe gave him a pair or some shit like that, and he wore them regardless back when they were, like, you know, when LeBron was in high school and shit. He said he wore them versus St. Vincent, St. Mary, so I don't know which one it would be, but he used to rock them.
And it was an amazing tribute. They played the Portland Trailblazers, which they were a great team back then. Big game opening night. This was ring ceremony night for the Lakers, for their second chip of the three-peat. And that's definitely the most iconic moment for the Kobe 2. Didn't have many others. He stopped wearing the Kobe 2. By the time they got to the finals in 2002, he went right back to the Kobe 1 because he just he didn't really want anything to do with this sneaker anymore. But it does go down in sneaker history. Whether you love it or not, whether you hate it or not, doesn't really matter. It's extremely famous, and it's part of the amazing sneaker history of Kobe Bean. Allen Iverson. So as you can see behind me, you got Pound.
All right, so we got Jordan, LeBron, Kobe. We got four, and now we're at five with Allen Iverson. And there's nine total. What I'm expecting, I guess, I know there's got to be a penny in there, whether it's a foam or a penny one, two, or I would say a penny one would be great in my opinion, but a penny, possibly, penny. I don't see why, like, a Kyrie or KD wouldn't be in here, honestly, but I don't, but he's doing greatest, so, Allen Iverson, penny's got to be in there then, penny one or something. I don't know if a Shaq would make it. Dennis Rodman, I don't know, Scotty. Let's go. Vince Carter, I don't know what to see.
Pound for pound right here, we got Bubba Chuck right back here. One of the best players, one of the most influential players in all of basketball history. And the reason that Allen Iverson became Allen Iverson, you can trace it back to Michael Jordan. He loved Michael so much that he wanted to follow in Michael's footsteps by being different. When Reebok approached him and said, yo, let's be different. Like, don't just wear Jordans like you did in college. Don't just wear Nikes like everyone else. Start your own thing, start your own way, be your own man. They came up with the Question Mid, which is, to me, a top five basketball sneaker of all time.
Yeah.
Just like the nicest, most premium tumbled leathers on the upper, super soft in the toe box.
It's one of, like, yeah, it's definitely like top five best basketball shoe. And as far as best shoes in general, I would put it in the top 10 list. Like, it is. The thing is, we don't give it as much love, or we don't shine light on it, because it's one model with so many good colorways. When you think about Kobe's, you can think about Kobe 5, the Kobe 6, the Kobe 7, the Kobe 8, the Kobe, like, there's so many different Kobe models that did good. Jordan, there's so many different models. With Allen Iverson, The question mid was good. The question, the answer was also well. Like Reebok answer, Reebok question, they were good. You know, even like the DMX vert, the ones I got with the BBC collab, those were good. But nothing hits like that. Like this one is the one that stands out. Very similar to that of the Penny. The Penny one was like the one. You know what I'm saying? And yeah, this one though shines. Like if you was to pull out every basketball player's best shoe and they can put them all in the bracket, this would definitely make it. Like if you pull Kobe only gets one shoe, Jordan only gets one shoe, LeBron only gets one shoe, you might have to put him in top three, top five, top three to five, top five. Like I'm like Jordan. I don't know what Jordan 11, Penny one, Reebok question. And then like a Kobe and a LeBron, like those are that five right there. That's tough.
Collar was beautiful.
Pippen
and they
too,
had the Hexalite technology in the midsole, which was it's based off of honeycombs. Honeycombs are one of the strongest natural structures that you'll ever find. They get their strength from their uniformity, from their connectivity. And so Reebok found a way to mold their midsole cushioning into this honeycomb-like structure. They call it Hexalite. This was included in Chuck's question mid, which is the shoe that he wore for his unbelievable rookie of the year season. And he was just doing all this, all the exaggerated 1-2 yo-yos, all that type of stuff. And we really saw him become pound for pound and start to make his way to be one of the best of all time, one of the most influential of all time. You know, AI, just like Mike and just like Kobe, just like KG, this was a man that just played with a fearless passion. And so it spoke to everyone that A, wanted to be like him, wanted to play like him, wanted his kicks that you see right here. So you mix all that together and you have pound for pound.
I don't know why, but like looking at the picture, well, maybe it's just from that side, but like they do like, they look taller than normal. I need to get the red joints, bro. They did drop too. I need to get the red one. I got the rookie of the year, which is red and blue. I think I just need to get the red ones, the OGs. But they got red with the red outlets. I don't think the ones that came out have that red on the outlets. I think they were white. I mean, let me just look that up real quick. They are. Okay. I'm looking at them. They look like they pretty much there. They still available? Oh, shit. Oh, there's a timer. I got to get these tomorrow, y'all. I got to get those boys. I got to get them. Whew. All right, let's go.
I'm the best to ever do it. PJ Tucker.
What?
We got to go back to the future.
PJ Tucker? Oh, okay, they still got those mids on deck, too. I might need to grab me this right here, bro. Oh, damn, they ain't got my size. Fuck.
Quick. So we got to talk about Marty McFly and the Air Mag. If we go back to the Future Part 2, famous scene, Marty McFly gets some auto-lacing shoes. And this was a sneaker. It wasn't fully functional yet. They had dudes laying on their stomachs behind Michael J. Fox. They were, like, pulling these little...
There's an actual video out there. I have not been able to find it yet. I need to look. Maybe I can look right after this video. There's a video that shows that how they actually made it juke on the shoes. There are people underneath the car pulling a string on the laces.
These little strings to make everything look like it was automatic. But even that was thought up by Tinker Hatfield, legendary sneaker designer, the best of all time, the Picasso of our time, Mozart, whoever you want to call him. And he came up with this shoe of the future. It was a super tall shoe, like almost a boxing boot type height. It said Air Mag. Like it had a bunch of stuff that people in the 80s weren't really used to seeing. And so that colorway, that specific colorway, is the direct inspiration for the shoe that you see PJ Tucker wearing right here. So for all the innovations that the Air Mag presented, now you look at this Hyperdunk, which is the 2008 model, the debut model of the Hyperdunk line. Hyperdunk line will continue for 10 different versions. But this 08 Hyperdunk, extremely, extremely influential, extremely technologically advanced by the time it came out.
But the Hyperdunk is PJ Tucker's shoe, or he was just the one that debuted it? Let me look that up. I remember seeing the Nike Hyperdunk. I think the Hyperdunk was just a shoe everybody you Okay. Yeah, because see, okay, this is what I'm saying. That's what he's saying, PJ Tucker. And I was thinking the same thing. But the Hyperdunk made its entrance in 2008. It was an extendable, fuck is this word, tied to time. It was debuted by Kobe in his appearance in Beijing. Let's see. Yeah, okay, yeah, Kobe did jump over the car and all that, right? Yeah. I don't know, man. Maybe somebody in the comment section can break that down a little bit more. But I remember seeing, did he debut in his shoes or what the fuck? Early 2000s, the hyper lightweight support was incorporated in the new silhouette in the Nike Hyperdunk 2008, which went viral with the help of Kobe Bryant and speeding sports car. Hyperdunk quickly grew popularity. I remember seeing this, and I remember seeing Kobe wearing that. Feel free to comment down below.
It's inspired by the cables that hold up bridges. So Nike designers were trying to find a way to cut weight. They were trying to find a way to make light basketball shoes because, you know, the athlete was evolving and growing. And you had dudes like Kobe, 6'6", who could easily take a beating, but that he could also fly. He was doing different stuff on the basketball court. And so they were trying to find a way to make a light but supportive shoe. And they looked at these bridge cables that held up these massive, massive structures without a ton of support. You know, you look at the Golden Gate Bridge, you look at the Brooklyn Bridge, it's not a ton of support that you see on the sides of that type of stuff relative to the actual structure that we drive over. So they found out that if you strategically place these cables in the right spots, they can hold up and support a massive amount of weight. So when you look at this Hyperdunk, you see the lines that go this way and this way all through the clear side of the shoe. That's called Flywire. And Flywire is the innovation that they were able to come up with, that they were able to get inspired by the bridges by. And so PJ, you know, he brought out this incredibly, incredibly influential sneaker in LA because Kobe Bryant was the person to debut the Marty McFly Hyperdunk way back in the day. He showed up in the DeLorean for the launch of this colorway, just like in Back to the Future, just like Marty McFly would have done with Doc Brown. So PJ, being the sneaker king, understanding moments, understanding the significance of where he's playing, understanding all these different factors, he broke these out, he changed out the white laces, he put in some pink laces, which was a super fire touch, and it just really does separate PJ Tucker as a sneaker king.
So once again, we got somewhat of another Kobe moment.
Because I'll tell you what, those sneakers right there are super difficult to find. Nate Robinson. Man, shout out to Little Nate. So we're here in...
I was talking about these just not that long ago on Richie Lee's channel, man.
In 09.
Some Flyposites, whatever they call them, the Flyposites.
Dunk contest in Phoenix. Kryptonite. Of the 2008 dunk contest when Dwight Howard stepped out the phone booth. He became Superman. He was dunking from like 35 feet away, just like catching the ball and just like throwing it into the rim just like that. He was flying like Superman. So Nate, he wanted to beat Superman. And what beat Superman? Kryptonite. And so Nike was able to hook up Little Nate with these amazing PEs. They say NR on the side of them. It's part of the Foamposite line. And the Foamposite line started with the Arizona Wildcats, technically, in 1997. Mike Vivian and the guys over there. This was a sneaker that was made for Penny Hardaway. But Mike Vivian and the Wildcats debuted them before Penny. The Foamposite one. Foamposite.
I heard that the phones were actually for Scotty, and Scotty didn't want them, and then they were given a penny. But I'll let Max tell it.
It's this shell-like material that's placed on the upper. It's this heavy plastic, but the amazing thing is that if you wear it enough, and we're not talking like, you know, you can't wear it for 2 weeks.
It's gonna mold to your feet.
2 months. You got to put some legitimate wear into it. But the thing will start to mold to your foot. So you put up with the heaviness of it because it will start to mold to your foot and give you this one-of-one feeling that you can't get in just another pair of ball off the shelves. So the Foamposite line has continued for years. It's been on.
Okay, so we're talking about foams, not just the Nate Robinson. We're talking about Nate Robinson, but we're talking about Foamposite, which I already said it had to be up in here. When I said Penny and Foamposites, but I think we're going to get a Penny one still then.
On everyone's feet since 1997. You know, you go down to the DMV in Washington, D.C., you see everybody wearing foams, foam ones and foam pros. That's like the official sneaker of the DMV. And then you go through the foam positive one into the LeBron's four, which had a foam positive material on it, into this foam positive light, which Nate wore. The foam positive, huge part of Nike's history in designing basketball footwear. And this moment right here, man, they just cooked up an amazing colorway. Nate won the dunk contest. He comes down off the rim. He takes off the shoes. He holds them up like a gladiator, like, are you not entertained type of thing. And, you know, this shoe is forever linked to Nate now, even if you don't have this exact colorway, but this foam positive light will forever be linked to Nate.
Two more. D-Brown. I think two more, right?
Oh, at the 1991 pumps. Dunk contest, D-Brown is out near half court. He reaches down, and he starts to pump up on the tongue of his shoe. He starts to run towards the rim, and everyone's like, yo, what's going on? He covers his eyes, and he dunks blindly in the dunk contest. Blindly, whoever knows how real it was. I'll give him the benefit of the doubt. Shout out to D-Brown. But he wins a dunk contest. And all of a sudden, the Reebok Omni Light just blows up. And this is part of Reebok's renaissance in the 90s, using the pump technology. That's what he was using on the tongues of his sneakers, was to pump up his shoes to give him an added structure.
That makes me think about my Air Commandos, which I need to probably rock pretty soon. They got the little pump bubble on the side that you can pump the shoe up with. It's a Nike product, and you press the air and it releases. But I never owned a pair of pumps from Reebok. Now, I think they dropped those recently, I think.
Of support in the ankle area of his shoe. So the Reebok pump is now part of a bunch of different Reebok sneakers. It launched in 1989, and then you fast forward to this moment in 91.
Well, they had the Furies, the pump Furies.
With the Omni Light. The way that it works, there are these inflation chambers within the shoe. So once you reach down it...
All right, don't fool them. Feed them full, you know. You heard me? All right, throw one of those, break one of them, pinch one of those treats in there. Grab one of those treats in that orange thing and pinch it. It'll break up and just drop it in there. You can break it. It's very easy. Just pinch it. It'll explode. Huh? All right.
And press on the actual pump device. The shoe will pump in air and it'll contract to your desired amount of lockdown. Revolutionary stuff for 1991 when production material wasn't where it is now.
Okay, Matt, huh? Yeah, I fed him earlier, but give him a little bit more. We have one more shoe, I think, left. We got Kobe, Jordan, LeBron, PG, or PJ, Nate, Allen, D. Brown. We got to get you got to, I don't know what you're going to do. You might do, because you got, there's a couple of shoes you got in here, bro. You got Ewings that I respect. You got Ewings, you got Mutombos, you got, I'm just trying to think what else, bro. I mean, you got Jordans too that you can throw in there. Like, but I just feel like Penny deserves, well, he got the foam, so. I'm just trying to think, is there anything else before I let it go? Like,
now,
the Jordan 1?
The materials that they had available to them certainly wasn't what it is now. So Reebok created an all-time classic silhouette with an amazing amount of technology in it. And this is also, hex technology was included in this shoe, just like it was included in the question mid. But D. Brown, man, synonymous with the pumps forever and ever and ever. It's been retroed a few times. It will go down in basketball sneaker history as a very defining shoe for a very defining dunk contest. Kevin Garnett.
The KGs? Them shoes with the IKEAs, or what the fuck do they call them?
A lot of people know KG for his time with Adidas when he was winning the chip in 08 with the Celtics. He had his own face on the side of his shoes. I don't know how people feel about that. That's kind of crazy. But before Adidas happened, before he signed with Adidas,
he was
Nike from 96 to 01. Had his own signature shoe. He had two of his own signature shoes. And before that, and in between that, the Garnett 2 never really got off the ground. But he was famous for wearing up-tempos, including Concord 11s. And once the Garnett series did officially launch, the Garnett 3 was by far his best shoe of the whole line. The whole line being two shoes, but it was a very revolutionary shoe. It used nice leather. And mesh uppers. It had a zoom.
It's got like Air Max vibes, like Air Max 98s, Air Max Pluses.
Airbag in the forefoot. Its defining piece of technology was the tuned air piece in the back of the heel. Tuned Air was made popular in the Air Max line a few years before it hit KG's signature line, but it's a separated air unit in the heel. Nike found a new way to manufacture the air that passes through those chambers. Unfortunately, KG's work with Nike ended soon after that, but the KG3, very underrated part of sneaker history. If you do know,
those are hard though. Have they dropped comments? They released these at all? These are hard though. I've never seen these.
Know about it, then you know, but that things were
still put penny there.
We're really looking up for KG's Nike line. If he had continued to stay with the swoosh, but luckily we do
those
have
hard.
The KG3. It retroed in 2015 under a different name. They removed Garnett's branding from the shoe. It seems like it will always be destined to be a sneaker for the heads. You know, something that the general public might not always appreciate as much as it deserves to be appreciated. Most amazing thing that I've seen in basketball footwear and that I've studied in basketball footwear is the connections that people now form.
They're called the Nike Air LE3. I wonder if they got these on StockX or something. They're on GOAT. They're $99. We have them on Amazon. Oh, they're sold out. Damn, they sold out. Let me see. Damn, they want $353 on StockX. Fuck that. Yeah, fuck that.
To the sneakers and the memories that they connect to, not only a play on the court, but first time that they saw a shoe on the court. The technology advancement that we've seen in footwear has been amazing. And, you know, now we have self-lacing shoes and Adidas has 4D printing and they have their Parlay for the Oceans thing where they're trying to help save the environment. That's all beautiful stuff. But the most amazing thing to me is the memories that we now form with basketball footwear. And it's the reason that I'm sitting here today talking to you guys.
Let me know you guys' thoughts and opinions down below in the comment section. If he missed anything or if you agree with this, let me know some shoes that he missed. I would love to hear these comments. Let's start up a little discussion and go from there. But I think this is a great video. I think it was a dope video, and I hope you guys enjoy it, man. So, yeah, man. I'm out. Links down below. Check it out. Peace.